Welcome back to the Imaginary Gallery. It's TJ, your host. Tonight's discussion is regarding the origins of abuse. Stems from the idea that many of us, when we were children, went through some kind of abuse, whether it was with family, peers, teachers, or any number of people. I picked up on the idea that if you've been through some kind of abuse in your early years, you may be more susceptible to falling for the cluster B narcissist, psychopath, sociopath, so on, creature when they prey upon you. I believe it's because even though the abuse itself is unacceptable, and if you saw it being done to another person, you could easily say, oh, that's unacceptable. However, if you've experienced it and you find yourself involved with somebody who's the most wonderful thing ever because of the love bombing and the fact that you don't know that you're in that cycle of three phases, you may simply put up with the abuse that they give. And if you try to protest, of course, they'll steer you off track or try to. So it may make us more susceptible to such behavior and to be more accepting of it, even though we know it's horrific. Look at my situation. I went from one to two and three in a row. I felt like a magnet with the word creature magnet. After escaping from one, finding another waiting to take its place. There's something wrong. I've heard in some lessons or discussions of abusive behaviors, if you find yourself involved with cluster B after cluster B, they say to look at yourself. What is it about you that is allowing this to happen? Again, it goes back to if you had the previous abuse experience, you may be more tolerant even though you object to it. It's just like familiar. If you've been through it when you were a kid and then you're an adult and someone does the same type of behaviors, you may be able to look at it and think, wow, that's childlike behavior. But usually they have you hooked in other ways, so you kind of just dismiss it or overlook it and hope that you're wrong. Unfortunately, you're probably not. For tonight's discussion, I'll be presenting three different stories. Two are mine, one is someone else, just to illustrate some examples of situations people have gone through. Hopefully this will encourage you, if you find yourself attracting cluster B after cluster B narcissist creatures, you may at least look back in your own history, see if you can find anything similar. Not that it means it's going to solve world hunger, but it at least may give you an insight into your origins of what you tolerated or were forced to tolerate at an early age, which may have made you more susceptible towards one of these creatures versus someone else who may get involved with the same creature, witness the first instance, which would be a red flag, of sickening behavior, and then just say, I'm out of here, and be gone. No turning back. Unfortunately, we don't always do that. That's our downfall. Example number one, my own situation. When I was a child going to grade school, I had a sister 3 years older. I saw as an advantage because she went through whatever I was about to go through, and she'd already done it from grade school to middle school. She was the one to say,
oh, in middle school, we don't have recess anymore.
I was a kid that loved recess. It was my favorite part of the day, so I was conditioned to believe, okay, well then when I go into the next school, I'll have to do without recess. Oh, because that means we're more adults. And all the usual mind control brain washing that goes along with that stuff. But in grade school, we learned to write. Standard hand printing. I got a clue from the older sister that,
oh, we learned to write cursive.
That was like fancy when you're a child. That's like a status symbol. Like, wow, I don't know how to do that. I made use of some of her books that she had when she was doing this. I would look up the letters of my own name. And I would practice writing out my own name with cursive letters. In my grade school class, we hadn't yet reached that point because I was 3 years behind her. I took it upon myself to think, wow, I have an extra insight. So when I got my papers and every time they have you put your name up there, I began putting a cursive T and a J, thinking I was so special, but I didn't brag or say, look how I signed it. I just did it and said nothing about it. This teacher evidently was an evil witch. We were about to learn cursive after like a year or so, and she had the nerve to state that day,
today we're going to learn cursive writing. Before we begin, I want to let you know that this is not the correct way to write a T in cursive.
And she put the T design exactly how mine was on my paper every day. Wasn't that sweet of her? I listened to her and looked at the design and thought, oh, that's exactly how she's going to teach us. But I was too young to know to question or stand up to people then. I just made a mental note and realized that there's something wrong with this lady. But she was making it a point to evidently smash down the student who looked ahead and bettered himself before they reached that in the class and thought she would attack him. Nice lady. I wonder where she is. I hope she rolls and spins in her grave. The second example I have is when I went into high school for the first year. I was a freshman, and I had the sister that was 3 years older, so she would be a what? A
senior.
Well, she would tell the social rules, like,
you're going to be a freshman.
And I'd look in the yearbooks and say, oh, well, who's this person? And she'd say,
that's a senior. He won't talk to you. That's a junior. She won't talk to you. They don't talk to freshmen.
Which set up a class system. Oh, if you're just a freshman, you don't count yet. You have to be further up. And I realized later, it's like, it's just 4 years. How much can you do in 4 years? But regardless, I found myself in an art class, which was a mixed class. It wasn't all freshmen, it was everybody. I found myself at a table with a bunch of mixed grades, including a senior girl. She was pretty and friendly. I was sitting by her. I knew the rules, so to speak, so I didn't initiate any conversation with anybody. I just sat there and listened. She became friendly and started talking, and I eventually learned that she was a senior. To my tiny little brain, that was like a big achievement, thinking, oh, I've got a senior talking to me and interacting with me, and I was told that seniors don't associate with freshmen. Oh, wow. And it was a feeling of status, happiness of, wow, I've really done something right. This girl would be friendly daily. We'd talk about stuff, not for dating purpose. It was just a peer in a classroom. I didn't know anybody, and here's somebody talking. I found the conversations interesting. I contributed to them, and I thought I was making a friend, and thought, wow, I've got a senior friend. After several weeks of class, all of a sudden one day, she came to class and started being really hateful and mean. Now I look back and wonder if maybe she knew this class system and thought she would get a fun, sick thrill out of pretending to be a freshman's friend and then turning on him. That was a memory that stuck with me. It was just strange because I felt really relieved and happy at first, and then she turned evil. And I remember one day I was like looking at her thinking, why is she being like this? Because nothing happened. There was no interaction outside of class that would have changed anything. I wasn't going to cry like a baby, but I did give a look, and she said,
what's the matter? You're gonna cry?
Which made it all even worse. Luckily I didn't, but I just learned at that point to sit elsewhere, not by this girl, and just made a mental note that, some people aren't as they seem. And isn't that strange? So that carried on over into adult life. It's sickening. Maybe if that hadn't happened, and I came across some of the creatures I did in adult life, I would not have given them another moment of my time. I would have dismissed them, but that's speculation. That's just an example of the sickness that was very meaningful to a kid of my age, being a freshman, thinking that I'd broken the odds and had a peer that was a friend that was older, but no. And the third example, a friend of mine I'd worked with for a while, we had another coworker with us that was telling tall tales, ridiculous stories about its lover, who was this famous person, yet nobody had ever seen this person, no photographs except from a magazine, all this talk about it, but never any instance of seeing it, because you'd think if you had such a famous, wonderful partner, it would come in at least to say hi to everybody, but never happened. The two of us would discuss it. We were coming to the conclusion that this is a lie, this person's lying. I watched this person also go over to the lying creature and be friendly with it. Later we were talking about it, and I'd said, why are you being so nice to that person? Why don't you tell him that you know he's a liar? And this friend of mine said,
No, I couldn't do that.
And he acted kind of strange about it all, because he was really vocal about his views of how this is probably a lie. But then when it came to the person personally, he was real friendly to it. And I just thought it was kind of strange. Like, you don't have to be mean, but you're being overly friendly. And the response I was given was,
well, when I was a kid, my mother organized a birthday party for me. She invited all the kids in my class. That day came, and nobody showed up. Because of that, I don't want to lose any friends. I see this person as a friend, even though it's lying.
And didn't want to risk that because of that childhood experience where it felt rejected by everyone, which made it, in return, desire to keep any friend it has. And this brings us to the idea of when you've been through abuse, typically there are two different ways you deal with it. One way we see is you turn around and you abuse others. The other way is you realize how horrifying it is and make it a point to not abuse others and to do the opposite of what abusive people do. I happen to fall in the second category. The purpose of this video, then, is not to be a witch hunt or to blame you for your own situation, but it's to allow you to introspect, to self-reflect, and look and see if maybe you experienced things like this that could have potentially affected your susceptibility to acceptance of such behavior in later years. It's just something to think about.
I am the Narcopath. I'm the sexiest one you've ever known.
I'm here to give you more of your favorite fabulous confessions. One thing I couldn't ever tell you when we were dating, or afterwards especially, is I don't have no emotions. I ain't got no what you all call empathy. I don't feel shame or guilt or none of that crap. But I know you all do. And it helps me to manipulate you so I can get what I want from you. I'd also like to reveal a secret to you. Top secret. It actually gets me off to see people like you, you privileged people, when you fail, when something goes wrong. Of course, the times it happened when I was around, I acted as caring as I could be. But you had no idea my face on the other end of that phone was laughing to hell because you all owe me. The world owes me. And how dare people like you be more successful than I am? It really made me feel great to find you failing. When you'd lost that job, I chuckled all night and I had a party. But of course I didn't tell you. You didn't need to know about it. See, I don't like the people I date. I just need to fill the time. I need to have someone because I can't be alone. I've got to be able to show the world that I'm worthy enough to have a partner. Never mind if I cheat on it every night. That doesn't matter. They don't need to see that. Plus, I have the hottest footwear. Oh, of anybody. Another trick I pull? Some of you all are wise guys and wise gals, and I don't like that. You all try to make a fool of me, but I don't allow it. So one of the things I like to do is I collect your insecurities. For example, when we went on that boat trip, you saw that cute lifeguard who was talking to me, Tommy. And he happened to know my name, which I tried to tell you.
Well, everyone thinks they know my name. Maybe he saw me on social media. I don't know him.
It really got you and your conspiracy mind going. You started asking questions.
How does he know your name? He looked at you like he liked you. I saw his eyes go down your chest and look at your teeth.
It's like, honey, everyone looks at my teeth. You think that? But then I'm dating everyone. Little did you know, probably was. Well, I have. I'm gonna. Regardless, that was one. And then we went on a vacation another time at a different city. At the hotel, by golly, the front desk clerk recognized me and said my name too. And I tried to tell you.
It's a coincidence. I just went along with it, to be polite. I've never seen him before in my life.
That got you going because you asked,
well, didn't you visit that city a few weeks back?
And I said,
sure, but I didn't see that person.
I changed the subject and moved on. The other time was when we went to my high school reunion. That other hot stud that was a football player kept giving me eyes and his tongue was hanging out of his mouth. You were under the impression I'd been seeing him lately and I said,
well, I haven't seen him since high school.
Well, all of that got you going. It got your conspiracy theories an uproar and you were asking questions day and night and I just loved the attention. It made me feel like I was worth something because you were so concerned about me. Of course, when you kept asking and you noticed little details that indicated maybe I wasn't being 100% honest with you, I then took that moment to make a face and say,
would you drop it? What is wrong with you? You're insecure. You're insecure. Just drop it. There's no one but you. Why are you so paranoid?
And that got you to shut up for a while. The trick I like to pull I didn't get to do with you. Because I found somebody else. I didn't need to mess with you. I'm telling you, it's gonna ruin it, so I guess I can't do it in the future. I collect insecurities as we go. Whenever you think you want to leave me, and you are beyond repairing, at least for the moment, then I reserve a special moment for you. That's the moment I get you to go down on your knees and scream.
For you, I would have said,
since we're breaking up, I thought you might as well know. Remember that boat trip we went on? And that guy, lifeguard? It's Tommy. We were doing it that night. Remember I told you I was sick in my friend's cabin? I was with that lifeguard and we were getting to know each other. And that hotel guy that you were so paranoid about that weekend? Remember that I was gone and went to the same city? And you couldn't reach me on your phone? I told you I had bad reception and a dead battery? Well, honey, I was with him all night making love and filling my insides with his beauty. Take that! And then at the high school reunion, same thing. Bingo!
If you ever try to ruin my life by leaving me, I was going to give you a little present, and that was going to be it. How does that make you feel? Does it make you wish we were still together now? Well, it's your loss, honey. I'm on to the next.
I like